Kiwi writer Emma Gilkison and her Peruvian partner Roy discovered during a routine scan that their baby boy had a medical condition so rare it happened to only 8 in 1 million babies. Their son's heart was growing outside his chest and they had to decide whether to terminate the pregnancy or continue with it, knowing he would die soon after he was born. Now, Emma has written a memoir in honour of their son and she is with us right now. Thank you so much for joining us, Emma.
Thanks for having me.
Gosh, what a thing to write. I mean, congratulations on your book too, The Heart of Jesus Valentino. Now, Jesus is your son, that's your son's name, obviously.
Yes.
You share a very personal experience in a very honest way and the book cover is so bright and so beautiful. Is this like a celebration of his short life?
Yes, yeah, absolutely. I guess for me, you know, the idea of a baby who only lives for 15 and a half days it's a very sad idea, but our son's life was also filled with so much love, and it was a really profound experience. So I wanted the cover to, you know, reflect a bit of the love and the joy that came of his life.
And you are a writer by trade. Was writing this memoir a form of therapy for you?
Yes, yeah, it was. I mean, I'm someone who writes to know what they think. So during my pregnancy, when I knew I was carrying this baby who was going to die, I journaled a lot. It was a way of processing emotions. But also I wanted to offer something to other families who might be facing a loss or grieving someone who's died.
And it's incredible, once you go through that process, there is a lot of people that you would have helped too by this book. Because there are a lot of people in not necessarily the same situation but similar situations as you, isn't there?
Absolutely, yeah. And you know, I would also add that miscarriage is very common, and I know that many women, you know, face grief after a miscarriage, and infertility is very common, and women also grieve the children that they haven't had.
Yeah, a great tool for people and a really beautiful thing that you've done, I think, to share your story. So let's recap a little bit. You and your partner have been trying for a while to become pregnant, correct?
Yeah, we were trying for a year or so.
Wow, okay, so once that happened, you found out about the condition, and it's called, excuse my pronunciation, ectopia cordis?
That's it, yeah.
Okay, cool. Tell us a bit more about that.
Okay, so it's a condition that affects about 8 in a million babies, and the heart quite literally grows outside of the chest. There are a handful of cases around the world where they have been able to put hearts back inside babies' chests, where surgery has been successful. And we were certainly holding out hope that that was going to be possible for our baby boy. But when I was about 5 months pregnant, that option was ruled out because not only was his heart in the wrong place, there were also some other structural defects. So it was just like too long a list of problems for any surgeon to attempt to fix.
At what stage in the pregnancy did you find out about the condition?
So we found out about ectopia cordis at the 12-week scan. Yeah.
And you were offered at that stage, you had the options to either terminate the pregnancy or continue, knowing that, well, your baby wasn't going to survive very long. So why did you make the decision to carry your child?
Well, you know, it was a really tough decision. And I think if I'd heard of another woman in the same circumstance that I was, deciding to bring a baby who was going to die to full term, I might have assumed she was a religious martyr or she was running away from the inevitable. But, you know, situations often feel different when you're actually in them. My partner and I both wanted to do whatever was the greatest act of love. For a while we had different ideas about what that meant. My partner thought we should terminate at one point because he didn't like the idea of our baby suffering after he was born. Whereas I had this idea that maybe our baby would prefer to have some life, even if it was only a little bit of life.
What was the reaction like once you'd made that decision, from your friends, from your family, from the medical profession?
I think we sensed that quite a lot of people didn't understand why we'd done what we did.
Right.
One way I had to explain it to people was, you know, if my mum or my dad was given 6 months to live, would I choose to say goodbye to them as fast as possible, or would I want to cherish every moment I have with them? And I want to cherish every moment. And it wasn't that different with my baby, albeit like quite a lot of his life, most of his life was lived inside my tummy.
Yeah, but that's a real connection when they're inside there doing their thing, is for sure.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
It's obviously a very rare condition. Did you manage to make contact with any other families around the world that had had babies with the same condition?
We did, yes. Yeah, so I learned about a little baby girl, Audrina, who had ectopia cordis that was operated on in Texas, and so I contacted her mum via Facebook. This was when we were still thinking that surgery might also be possible for our baby, and she sent me a lovely message back, you know, saying, you know, hang in there, and yeah, so that was nice.
It must have given you some strength.
Yes, yeah. I mean, we received an incredible amount of support, I would have to say. You know, we were surrounded by a whole lot of love and compassion. So there's a wonderful organisation called SANS in New Zealand that supports families who've lost babies, and Vicky Culling and Joan Curl, two of their volunteers, came to visit me regularly through the pregnancy, and they did so much for us. They organised for a photo shoot on the very last day of my pregnancy. Actually, I went into labour that night, but so we had, you know, a photo shoot then, and also when our baby was a week old, so we had these, you know, beautiful photos taken by a photographer free of charge. They also really emphasised the importance of making good memories, which would help us in the grieving process. And so, based on that idea, I actually went to Tonga swimming with the whales and their calves when I was 35 weeks pregnant, because that was kind of an experience that I could have with my baby.
Wow, that's what an extraordinary experience. Yes. And you've had another baby now, though, haven't you?
Yes, yeah, I've got a little boy who's 2 years old now, Amaru, and he's very healthy.
Was that a little bit scary for you? Because obviously a very rare condition, but did you have in the back of your mind, what if something else happens?
I did, yeah, I did. The timing was actually really good because, it was just after the 1 year anniversary of Jesus Valentino passing that I had the 12 week scan for my next pregnancy. And it felt like, you know, we'd had a year to grieve. We had a lovely grave unveiling. Then we had a 12 week scan which said everything looks fine. And we were really ready to welcome a new little one into our lives by then.
Yeah. It's incredibly amazing that you've shared your journals in this book and that you can help people as well. What do you want them to get out of this book?
Well, you know, for someone who's grieving, I guess I want to offer my experience so that they know they're not alone and they know that, you know, there is hope and light at the end of really dark, difficult experiences. There's a quote that I really like by Joseph Campbell, which says, the cave we fear to enter holds the treasure that we seek. And I think it's very true. You know, sometimes the things that seem the most awful and scary can actually prove profound and full of love.
Well, Emma, thank you so much for joining us today. Emma's book, The Heart of Jesus Valentino, is an amazing, not to mention heart-rending read, and it's available at good bookshops right now.
Yes, what a beautiful tribute to Jesus.